Well, I don't think I'll be using the manual, but anyways, there's the parts I've got to change. I'll explain what happened.
I think this beast is a 92. My buddy traded it for his car that he got rid of because he bought a newer car. And anyways, the guy lied to him and said the motor's perfect and it runs great. It's so damn hard to start and the compression's really low and it only has half the power. So I was wondering why, when it was running with that low of compression, why it wasn't smoking. So I asked him to remove the rocker cover and we'd check the valve adjustment, see if it was losing compression through the valves. Well, let me explain what we found.
Well, here we are looking below the rocker cover. First thing we notice right away is it's got one cam lobe, opens two valves, it's four valves per cylinder. So there's a double-sided rocker. Well, here, one side is snapped right off. And the chunk had fallen down in there, and it was rubbing on the cam, and it really divoted the cam, so it's all messed up. So, of course, we need rocker arm. Well, we have that over there. He managed to find used parts on the internet.
But, of course, why did that happen?
Rocker arms just don't break off.
Well, obviously what happened is someone over-revved the machine, so the piston hit the valves. While the valves were trying to open, the pistons pushing them closed, so something had to give.
So it broke one of the rockers off, so...
That explains, by having one intake valve and not two, why it had a lot less power. But should have had good compression, but it doesn't. So, of course, since the pistons did hit the valves, they're both a little bit bent. So that's why it's hard to start and has bad compression.
So, I do have two spare valves there to change. But
I have my redneck technique of fixing broken valves. And you'll see how I do that in a moment. I showed it on a previous video a couple years ago I put on the internet with a lawnmower engine. I use it on cars, bikes, everything. I've never ever had an engine that didn't have perfect compression after that, or a valve that ever broke afterwards. It's so simple. You don't even have to remove the valve, and it's so easy to check. I'll show you. But let me get this sucker apart first.
I've never worked on one of these things before, but it looks pretty much the same as any other modern engine. Alright, I've unbolted all the peripheral bolts and all the hardware, carburetor, exhaust, everything that was attached externally to the head, water pipe. So now I've got the last four bolts to do, which are all blocked by either a pressurized oil passage tube or a rocker arm or something. So I've removed the cam chain tensioner and I've taken off the side cover, you know, access ports. And I see if you can see this, but way in that little hole you see a little like zero and a T beside it. Then if you move it over a little bit that way, you'll see a little thing with another zero and an F beside it. So T means top dead center, and F means fire, when the spark plug fires, which is in advance. So you line up the little zero to that notch there, just by rotating that nut, which is very easy. And then you just check that your cams are in line where the points line up, so you know how to put it back together. So now I remove the both cam shafts, and I make sure the chain doesn't fall all the way down inside the motor, so I'll get a string or a piece of wire and just tie it up and hang it on the frame. And it looks like there's enough room to get the head out of here. Should be no problems. No, I haven't run into any so far. Well, that was too easy to unbolt all the cam things. So just make sure when you take this apart you don't drop any of these alignment dowels, which are so loose, and have them fall way down inside the motor. Then you'll be fishing them out with a magnet. So now I'm ready to remove the cams. And you can really see how the hell has just been chewed right out of that sucker. But lo and behold, that cam looks really nice. Not perfect, but good enough. I'll just remove the other cam now, tie up the chain, and get out the rest of those head bolts. Well, that's all done now. Now I know where Kawasaki Green comes from. The green Martian juice that drains out of these machines.
Oh well, now you gotta make paint.
All the bolts are out. I suppose the head is ready to lift off. Timing chain is tied up. Yep. I guess it'll slip right out now. Sweet.
Oh, just like that. Now I just gotta move the wire for my chain.
Cool. Now we're going to see what damage is done. That all looks in good shape. This accident to the engine happened a long time ago, so you can't see any fresh, clean dent marks on the piston where the valves hit it. But I'll show you how to test now for bent valves. Okay, since these valves are only slightly bent, you can't visually tell that they're bent unless you open and close them. To open and close them, you just get your fingers in there and squeeze the valve springs on the other side and open the valve just a tiny bit and then slowly close it. If any of the valves move sideways in any direction, usually in this direction of course, means it's bent. When the valve closes, it should not move at all. It should just stay in almost exactly the same position. So I'll show you what I mean. I can't tell if you'll be able to see this on camera, but I'm going to open and close the intake valves, and you guys can see if they're going to move a little bit slightly. I'm just pushing this with my thumb. Now I'll try the other one. Well, when I just tried this before I turned the camera on, I could see them moving. So they're bent. So I just take a handy little screwdriver, pry them open, shove the screwdriver in between the valve and the valve seat. It doesn't hurt anything. Bend it over a little bit and keep trying and opening and closing them like I'm doing now until they don't move sideways anymore and they're fixed and they won't break and it won't never cause a problem. You can slam the whole bitch back together and be confident that you have get a perfect compression if you can do it as good as I can. So I've just got done double checking all the four valves by pressing them and letting them go and see if they move side to side, and now they're all good. So now I just got to clean the gasket surface a little bit. I've already done that on the head, got the new head gasket on, made sure my two alignment dowels are in there. I removed this cam chain slide to make it easier to put the head back on, then I just drop it down and hooks into a little notch. So I'll drop it down once the head's on. So now I just gotta slip the chain through the head as I'm setting it on. Gently set the head on, put that on, and we're ready to start slamming everything back together. Oh well, it's only a one beer job so far, but we're just about half done. Oh yeah, before I put the head back on, it was a little bit easier to change that broken rocker while the head was off, so she's done. Well, now ready to start putting all the bolts back in. Got the cam chain slider in already. When tightening small cylinder heads like this that are usually just a few bolts, you do them in the crisscross pattern, corner to corner. You do them in stages. Some people think you need a torque wrench, but I never use one, so I've never had a head gasket go bad that I fixed anyway, so I trust my experience feel. Now it's easiest to reassemble this is to put the exhaust cam in first and set up the little pointer to level with the head so it's going to be in the right position when we recheck this and make sure it's on TDC. Now I just got these finger tight and I'll tighten them all up with the ratchet, and then after everything's assembled and I get the other one in for the intake, I'll definitely have to check the valve adjustments because this is a completely different rocker and cam. So definitely they're going to be a little bit out, and you have to get exactly the same space under each one. And I didn't forget to put the pressurized oil tube back in, which is a very good idea. And I did give the cam journals and lobes and everything a shot of oil, of course, before you reassemble. So it was a bit tricky to get both cams lined up so those dots are on the top edge of the head synchronized. And I've got the little line in there for the top dead center lined up, so we're all set now. All I gotta do is adjust all the valves, and then we can put the rocker cover on and throw on all the peripherals and we're ready to ride. Well, it's a few days later and the owner of the quad I just got done fixing the head on came back and put all the plastics and peripherals on, and we're gonna see if it fires up and how it runs now. Looks good. Right. Wanna see if this mother runs?
Yeah, let's see. It's all back together.
Took longer for him to put it all back together than it did for me to fix it.
Oh yeah, so I want that bolt. for it.
Choke on?
Nope.
Sure you don't need it?
Put the choke on.
Got lots of compression now?
Oh yeah.
Is it turned on? Come on, you're making me look bad. It should start right up. Uh-oh. It kicks backwards, so it makes it hard to kick. Oh. Yes!
It's all about finding that sweet spot.
Yep, and I didn't even adjust the valves of the feeler, I just adjusted them by my own feel. That runs nice and quiet. Now that the rain has stopped, you'll be able to go out and try it. Cool. Definitely sounds a lot snappier. Wheelie machine!
Alright, as soon as we get that piece of shit out of the way and fixed, we'll be ready for a test drive. Maiden voyage, Riders on the Storm. Cool.
Maiden voyage.
Yep. And it lives again to die another day. Sweet.